God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds a victory. His joy lies in the Lord. His joy.
Overcame it all. He has won all three. Shall not kneel, shall not faint. By His blood and in His name, His name. your name is victory. And all praise will rise to Christ our King. And your name is victory. And all praise will rise to Christ our King.
Resurrecting me, resurrecting me, resurrecting me. I am spirit.
You give life, you are love, you bring life to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out.
Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, his bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
You are the risen King.
Father, God, we thank you for the work of Jesus Christ. God, that was finished on the cross. God, that our sin, that our shame was taken on the cross. That you took it. That he who knew no sin became sin for us. That we might become the righteousness of God. God, we thank you for that. We thank you that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, lived the perfect life that we couldn't live and died the death that we deserve because of our separation. God, that sin is caused. God, that he gave us the ministry and the spirit of reconciliation, the spirit of adoption over our lives, that we can become sons and daughters of God. We lift up the name of Jesus. We thank you for the resurrection of Jesus. God, that the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in me. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead. God, our plea, each and every one of us, is that it lives in me. He lives in me. Holy Spirit, thank you for your presence. God, thank you. God, for this room full of people and rooms full of people all across, God, this nation right now. God, earlier in this day, God, before we were even awake, that there were rooms full of people and there were huts full of people and there were outdoor areas with no roofs that were just laden with people worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords because you had brought salvation to us, God, to the entire world. God, we thank you for the finished work of Jesus, the power of God at work in our lives. We thank you for redemption. We thank you for freedom. That we do not have to be bound in sin. We do not have to be bound in shame. We do not have to be bound by failure. But God, we are free in Jesus' name. Because the power and the work of Jesus, nothing we could do. Nothing we could earn. Only what we could receive that you've already done. So God, we thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence. We thank you, Jesus, for the work you did on the cross. We thank you, Heavenly Father, God, that your plan was always Jesus. He was always plan A. He wasn't the backup plan after sin entered the world, but he was the Lamb who was slain before the foundation of the world because you so loved us in this room, us in this world, that you looked down and decided that we were your favorite.
you out to be walking in this room. Come on, let's lift it up to him.
Death will not hold you down. You are the
manifest in a special way when we come together. God, that you dwell amongst the praises of your people. So God, we thank you, God, that your Spirit is drawing us, that the kindness of the Holy Spirit is drawing us, is convicting us of sin, is leading us to a place of repentance. We thank you, God. God, the shed blood of Jesus provides provision for our healing. Jesus' name. God, that as we are in Christ, that you have given to us the mind of Christ. God, I pray that the peace that passes all understanding would settle on us, regardless of our situations, regardless of our circumstances, that the peace of God that passes understanding would rest on us in Jesus' name. God, we trust you. We thank you for our time together. God, continue to minister to us, God, through your word. Continue to minister to us, God, as we worship you, God, in our giving. Continue to minister to us. God, speak to our hearts. We praise your holy name. In Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. You can be seated in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. It is so good to see you here this morning. So wonderful to worship with all of you. You can continue in your worship through your giving at newriverschurch.org/give, or we have a box just outside this middle door. If you feel led to give your tithes and your offerings, you can do that way, or at newriverschurch.org/give. But we are just thankful for your faithfulness, but even more so, I'm thankful for God's faithfulness. Amen?
Amen.
God is... never let me down whenever I continue to give him what it is he has declared is already his. We have, next up, don't just lead me through them. We want to say thank you for being here. I'm sure we probably have some first-time guests here this morning. Would you give it up for our first-time guests? Yeah. It's good to see you this morning. I'm not probably back to that one. You're doing a great job, Bus. Exactly what I need. But fill out a guest card in the seat back in front of you if you would. So that's right in the back of the seat in front of you. There's a little card that says thanks for coming. And then it's got a place for you to give us some information. And we'd love for you to trade that in at the Welcome Center, and we want to give you a gift. But if you don't turn that in, or you forget to fill it in or whatever, we'd still love to give you a gift at the Welcome Center. So please stop by the Welcome Center. Just go all the way down there, and it'll be on your left. You'll see it. It's a thing. It's a whole deal. You'll know what's going on. All right. Yeah, you can get ahead of me, Joel. There we go. No Bible study tonight. Enjoy the holiday with family and friends. And then we do have prayer on Wednesday at 6 o'clock. It is somewhere between 6 to 6:45 or 6 to 7:15 or 6 to 7:30. Usually it's closer to 6:45 or 7, but we don't really kind of put a cap on it. But we also want you to know you are free to come and go as you need to if you want to attend Wednesday evening prayer. And you're like, I can't be there right at 6, but I would love to come pray. We'd love for you to come pray for part of it. That'd be fantastic. Or if you can be there at 6, but you're like, I can't stay till 6:45 or especially 7:15. We'd love for you to join us for part of it and pray starting at 6 as well. So we'd love it. I think I've been pretty clear about that, right? We would love it. Community prayer is always the first Tuesday of the month. It is no different this month, so 6:15 to 6:30. We'd love for you to join some of the people from our body and then several people from other bodies as well at the Courthouse Gazebo. And then we've got some people that have made some crosses. And so if you'd like a pre-made cross for your yard, you can pick one up in the foyer today. And that's just right over here, right? So if you go out this middle door, there'll be a box and there'll be crosses in it. You don't even have to sign up. You just want one, place it in your yard. Just as kind of a silent act saying, hey, I'm a follower of Jesus and I'd love to put this in my yard. You can. And if not, there are lots of ways to show that you love Jesus. So that's all right too. Anything else, Joel? Yes, growth groups. It's not too late. Our growth groups are how we in smaller groups and usually in homes, one group online, one group meets at the church, and then I think the rest of them in homes. It's our discipleship process where iron sharpens iron, so does one man sharpen another. And so we'd love for you to join a growth group, sign up, get involved. There's quite a few, but they're also getting pretty full. Proud of you. You guys are doing great. Proud of you. And then anything else, Joel? That is it. It's Easter. You want me to let you know it's Easter? Students, grade 6 through 12, if you want to go downstairs, there's, I'm sure, some fun stuff going on down there with youth ministry. Everybody open your Bibles up. The rest of us, the remnant that are over the age of 12th grade, to John chapter 20. I just want to read through part of the resurrection account as John records it. Matthew records the resurrection. Luke records the resurrection. John records the resurrection. And Mark records the resurrection. Those are what we call the four gospels. And they're called the four gospels because they are full of good news. There's plenty of bad news in the Bible, if you didn't know. This thing called sin that separates us from God. It means missing the mark. When we make mistakes, whenever we fall short of the perfect standard that is God, there's something that is called sin that separates us from this perfect God. But God had a plan, and he was always the number one plan, and that was that God would send his son to fix that sin problem. If you didn't know, sin separates us from God, not just in the here and now, and makes us uncomfortable and like, well, there's a good God and he's not happy with me. It's worse than that. And he said, there's a good God and I'm so separated from him that I suffer eternal death without him reconciling that, okay? And so God's plan was always that he would send his son, Jesus Christ, and Jesus would live that perfect life that none of us in this room had lived and nobody except Jesus ever lived, and that Jesus would die in our place. Instead of us having eternal death and separation from God, we have eternal life because of Jesus. And Jesus was one man that died so that all might live. And that is recorded in all four of these Gospels. And I will talk a little bit more about these Gospels and how important these accounts are in a little bit. But I've been going through the Easter account kind of starting with we didn't start Palm Sunday, did we? I think we started on Wednesday. I don't know when we started. I started taking my kids through the Easter account and their Bible. And it's really the first time we've taken through a specific set of stories in like a Bible. They've got a wonderful children's Bible that they've both now read through multiple times. If they can do it, so can you, just so you know. And if you're like, I'm not good at reading my Bible, get your children's Bible, because that'll help you too. At least get you started, get you going. But my kids have read through this children's Bible multiple times, but we just started taking them through the Passion Week, and man, it started to move me. And it also it allowed them to share some questions, because I don't know if you ever realized it, and I've told you before, it's a pretty wild story to believe that there was a guy who called his own death, burial, and resurrection and then pulled it off. Like, that's hard to believe, right? It's hard to believe a lot of the things that happened in the Bible, and that's why we ascribe them or describe them to be miraculous, correct? And so our kids were able to begin to ask some questions, and instead of just reading a story and it almost seeming like fiction, even though we're like, it's not fake, you know, we're going through it. And so they begin to ask us some questions. And as Friday, I was reading the account of how the thorns were placed on Jesus' head. And I mean, I read this all the time. I read through the Bible every year. I'm a pastor. I prepare for Easter every year. I talk about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus a whole lot. But as I'm reading through it, I'm like, did you notice? I was like starting to crack. Anyway, I was like, I don't know. I feel like I'm about to break down. You know, just the realization that these thorns, and then Jesse's pointing at them, they're big thorns. They're like 4-inch thorns. I'm like, stop. She did. She could see it. She's like, see it too well enough. She's like, I'm going to get this. But I just, the reality of the thing, like when we really believe it, like when you really believe that Jesus went through what we're all in here singing about, oh man, it's painful. It's hard because that's what I deserve. Right? The whipping and the beating that Jesus took, that's what you and I deserve because of the sin in our life that has separated us from God. The death that he deserved, the brutal crucifixion, not that he deserves, excuse me, the death that he took for us, the brutal crucifixion of Christ, is what you and I deserve. And the mocking, right? Why did they put a crown of thorns on his head? It wasn't just so they could be mean and they put crowns of thorns on everybody's head. They said, you think you're a king? And then they shoved these thorns into his head, mocking him. And the whole time, Jesus could have called it off. Like Jesus could have, he could have felt that first thorn go in and say, nope, I'm not doing this. This is not, it's not happening. He could have called them off. He could have, like anything you can imagine from some sci-fi movie where somebody uses the force or whatever, he could have blinked his eye, could have twitched his nose like in the old TV show, whatever he wanted, and sent those people flying. And he didn't. Why? Because that's the totality of what our sin is owed to us. That's the totality of the shame that should be on us if it weren't for Christ, and would be on us if it weren't for Christ. That's what he went through. And then he went to the cross and he breathed his last breath and he said, it is finished. And then yesterday we had a men's breakfast, right? And at our men's breakfast, we're in there and we're eating and we're having a great time. It was a wonderful men's breakfast. I don't know, maybe 30, 40 guys in there and wonderful food. And I don't know, Sheila's probably in children's ministry, but and Sheila, Estep, she helped and she did a wonderful job. And Ray and Danny did a great job getting it set up. But like we're there on this Easter weekend Saturday and we're eating food and we're having a good time and we're letting our sons run around together and experience, you know, this Christ-like bond that we all have. And, you know, in the back of my mind, I'm like, this is when the disciples thought they lost. Like, we can have that wonderful fellowship and that time together because we know we won. We know Jesus won. But on that Saturday morning after the crucifixion, Peter had already started fishing. He'd already decided that he was no longer a fisher of men, but he was just a fisherman. Right? They had broken hearts. They thought that this thing was over. They didn't understand, most of them, that when Jesus said he would tear down the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, that he was talking about his body. And so they are lonely. I mean, if you could just think of the loneliest you've ever felt, I've got to think that's exactly, except one-tenth maybe, of everything that they felt when they had been with the person of Jesus Christ, and now they thought it was a sham, he was a liar, he's not the victor anymore, I'm so confused, I don't know what to do. Like, I'm not saying that that was all of their outcomes, but those things are going through their heads because everyone's shocked when they see him again. They thought the grave would still be with a body in it. They wanted to make sure nobody else had taken the body out of the grave. John chapter 20, if you are there, then you'll be with me. If not, then you'll hear me read. Starting in verse 1, reading through verse 18, it says, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark. She saw the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she went running to Simon Peter and to the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said to them, they've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they put him. At that, Peter and the other disciple went out, heading for the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and got to the tomb first. Stooping down, he saw the linen clothes lying there, but he did not go in. Then following him, Simon Peter also came. He entered the tomb and saw the linen clothes lying there. The wrapping that had been on his head was not lying with the linen clothes, but was folded up in a separate place by itself. The other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, saw, and believed. For they did not yet understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to the place where they were staying. But Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she was crying, she stooped to look into the tomb. She saw two angels in white sitting where Jesus' body had been laid, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, woman, why are you crying? Because they've taken away my Lord, she said, and I don't know where they put him. Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. But she did not know it was Jesus. Woman, Jesus said to her, why are you crying? Who is it that you're seeking? Supposing he was the gardener, she replied, sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him, and I will take him away. And Jesus said to her, Mary. Turning around, she said to him in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, don't cling to me since I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and tell them that I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. And Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, I have seen the Lord. And she told them what he had said to her. Heavenly Father, I love you. I thank you for the word of God. I thank you that we have these resurrection accounts, God, to look to hold on to believe in, to place our faith in the significance of that event. Father, I pray if there's anybody in here who came in and said, I'm just going to go to a church on Sunday morning because that's what you do on Easter Sunday, and I'm going to be there, and it'll be for somebody else, and that's that. Father, I pray that the reality of Jesus Christ would well up in their soul. God, that even in this moment, that it would be like the experience that Mary had whenever she walked in and she saw him. And God, that you would speak their name to them. God, that they would sense your calling. They would sense the ultimate teacher, the one who loves us. They would sense you're directing them to yourself. God, as the sacrifice, as the substitution for our sins. God, as you spread your arms out on the cross and displayed your love for them, God, that there would be this reality in this moment. God, as the saints pray and the saints believe, God, there'd be a reality for them in this moment that truly he is the Son of God. Jesus Christ is the place of salvation. He is the one who brings salvation. And that they would put their faith in you in Jesus' name. God, help us all to be better followers of you, to do what you've called us to do. God, let your will be done in Jesus' name. Amen. This song that we sang a million times today, once right after Ray kind of opened us in prayer, and then again at the very end of worship, that song is called The Anthem. So if you just want to listen to it sometime, it's called The Anthem, and it's by a group called Planet Shakers. But the title of that song just really caught my eye. We had been discussing singing that song for probably 2.5 or 3 months now, and Easter seemed like the best time to say, okay, we're definitely going to introduce that song because it is powerful, and it truly is just an anthem of the redeemed. It is an anthem of the saints. And you're like, what's an anthem? Well, an anthem, according to, I don't know if this is Webster or just the internet dictionary Google decides to do, but either way, it's got to be pretty legit. An anthem is a rousing or uplifting song identified with a particular group, body, or cause. So it's a song basically that, like, if we were to say, okay, we got to figure out something we can get behind, something that's going to get the troops going. You know, if we were going to head out to spiritual warfare, then we say, hey, we've got to figure out something that everybody can join together. It's going to boost morale. We're going to be as ready as we can possibly be. And I know we all have different favorite songs, and some of you, your favorite song, you're like, you haven't sung it in forever, because my favorite song is a hymn. That's okay, too. And like, you can pick, like, well, that'd be my anthem. But I think we can collectively agree that this is a pretty good anthem for those who are in Jesus Christ. By his stripes, we are healed. By his nail-pierced hands, we are free. By his blood, we're washed clean. Now we have the victory. If you believe it, say amen.
Amen.
The power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all. He has won our freedom. Jesus has won it all. If you believe it, say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You have won the victory. Hallelujah. You have won it all for me. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King. Seated in majesty, you are the risen King. If you believe it, say amen.
Amen.
And then part of the song we didn't sing just says, our God is risen. He is alive. He won the victory. He reigns on high. Our God is risen. He is alive. He won the victory. He reigns on high. If that's true, shout amen.
Amen.
I think that's a pretty good anthem. I think as a believer in Jesus Christ, that there's only one thing I see in there that I'm like, there might be people who would debate that. And the one, I'll just share that one part of thing that I, one piece that I think people might debate, and that's just where it says, you've done it all for me. Some people will be like, oh, that's very ethnocentric, or that's very people-centric, that's very person-centric, and so that you've won it all for me, you've done it all for me, it's hard for me to get behind that. And this is what I would suggest to you. Everything that Jesus did, he did to the glory of the Father, to be in the Father's will. That is why Jesus did everything he did. But Jesus was sent on assignment by the Father because the Father looked down and God so loved the world, which is a bunch of me's, a bunch of I's, right? And that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believed in him would never perish but have everlasting life. And so if you're like, well, I'm hung up on that, that can't be my anthem, I need you to bear with me and be okay with the fact that God loves you so much he sent Jesus to die for you. Amen?
Amen.
So I think that's a pretty good anthem. You know, as a country, we have the national anthem. And our national anthem, I tried to sum it up in just a few words. And like, what does that look like? Because here's what we need to know. Everybody has an anthem. Like, you may not have put it down. You may not have written the song like Francis Scott Key did, right? Like, you may not have written a song out and said, this is my song, this is my anthem. But we all have an anthem. We all have something that we are moving towards, that we are jacked up about. And our national anthem is about perseverance. It's about freedom. It's about courage. Right? It's that even though the battle was going, they looked up, they still saw the flag, they still had hope, they still had belief, even though bombs were bursting, we still knew, we're going to win this thing, we're going to be okay. Like, that's the national anthem, perseverance, freedom, courage, and I think it's a pretty good song with a pretty good message, okay? At least the verse I know. I don't know the other verses. You don't either. But anyway, some are like, yes, I do. Well, good. Good. You're wonderful. We love you. God bless you. Come back next week. But anyway, you can stay for now too. That's fine. But that's our national anthem. I was thinking about people in the Bible. John the Baptist. What was John the Baptist's anthem? I would say John the Baptist's anthem was, repent. You're bad. Right? Repent. You're bad. The kingdom of heaven is coming. That's a pretty easy one to grab because that's basically all he ever said. He called people vipers and stuff like that, but essentially he said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Right? He's just letting everybody know, you need to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. There's one who is coming whose sandals I am not fit to tie or untie or anywhere in between. The kingdom of heaven is coming. And so John the Baptist, he was looking towards something. John the Baptist had this hope that the Messiah is on his way. I am a precursor to the Messiah. And so I need to let you know what the Messiah is going to ask of you. And if you didn't know, the Messiah is asking this of you. The Messiah wants you to repent. Just like John the Baptist was telling people, the Messiah wants you to repent. You're like, what's the Messiah? Okay, that's a Hebrew word. And it means Savior. It's really, I think the Hebrew word is like Messiah. But anyway, Messiah means Savior. It means that we are in need of salvation because of our sin problem that I've talked about a few different times now. And we need a Savior to come. And John the Baptist was letting people know the Messiah is coming, the kingdom of heaven is coming. But most everyone received his message to mean, we aren't going to be under Roman occupation much longer. We are repenting, we are turning to this one true God, and he's going to free us from a Roman occupation. And so John the Baptist has his anthem, and people are buying it. People are getting baptized. People are getting dumped into the Jordan River. And so it's an exciting time. He even ends up baptizing Jesus himself. And so it's a wonderful time in John's ministry with the song that he is singing. But the song that John the Baptist sang is nowhere as good as the song that a believer in Jesus Christ today is able to sing. The Sadducees in the Bible, in the New Testament, we see that Jesus opposes often or comes into opposition from the Sadducees and the Pharisees. And the Sadducees were a little bit different than the Pharisees, kind of in the same grouping of the ruling class of the Jewish people of the day, on the Sanhedrin Council, which was their ruling council. But the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection of the dead. And so the Sadducees' anthem would have been something like, live for God now so you'll have a blessed life. Because throughout the Old Testament or the Hebrew Bible, the Word of God is clear many, many, many times that as we follow the path that God has laid forward in his law, as we follow the law, that there is a blessed life that God is promising to those who follow the law. And so the Sadducees, not believing in a resurrection of the dead, literally believing that like at the end, it's just the end. Like, you just close your eyes one last time, and it's over. It's just nothing. I guess it's just, you know, everything just vanishes as far as your consciousness goes and your understanding of everything. So they would have said, you need to live for God now. You need to follow the law now so that you can have a blessed life today. And I'll let you know, if you follow God's word, I believe you'll have a blessed life today. I'm not talking like, You go and you prophesy over your Lamborghini or just a Mitsubishi that's out of your price range. I don't care what it is. Like, I'm not talking like that. I'm talking about like whenever we follow what God has prescribed for us, that we find that blessing does follow after us. Psalm 23, verse 6 says that surely goodness and mercy will follow after me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. Like, that's our reality. Like, the Sadducees were right. Like, they weren't wrong about that. If you follow what God has called you into, then you will have a blessed life. At worst, you will have a better life than if you didn't. Right? And so they had, that was their anthem, but obviously the anthem of the saint is better than the anthem of the Sadducee. Because the anthem of the Sadducee didn't believe in an eternal life, didn't believe in an eternal inheritance like we believe in an eternal inheritance. If you're in here and you're like, I'm new to this whole thing, I don't even know what you're talking about. We believe in an eternal inheritance that we're actually called co-heirs with Jesus Christ. That Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father in heaven, enthroned in power, and somehow I am a co-heir with Christ. I've even been given the authority that Christ has been given. Jesus, he's very clear when he talks to his disciples after the resurrection and before the ascension. He says, listen, all authority in heaven and on earth have been given to me. He wants them to know, it's been given to me. Right? And then he tells them, therefore, you need to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. I just want you to know something. If it was just the 12, that's not possible. Right? Jesus is speaking more than just to the 12 at that point. He's letting them know personally, but it echoes throughout the ages. It echoes throughout the centuries as the church has expanded, as the church has grown, as the church has reached nation after nation after nation and continues to reach unreached people groups. And we support missionaries in this place to help reach unreached people groups that have never heard the gospel, to get a Bible in their language. That continues to happen. And Jesus continues to let us know that with his authority, that we can go and make disciples, that we can go and baptize people in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then he adds that little wonderful, amazing promise that don't you dare ever leave off the end of that verse. And he says, and lo, I am with you always to the very end of the age. And I don't think it was an accident that Jesus sent them on mission and said, and I am with you always. Why? Because we need Jesus to be on mission. And I'm not so sure how close we are to Jesus when we're not on mission. And then the Romans of the day, they had an anthem. They borrowed it from the Greeks of the day. And their anthem would have just been eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die, right? Carpe diem. That's all there is to life. Just eat, drink, be merry, for tomorrow we die. And that is, I'm not trying to be political here, but I'm just talking ideologically. If you're wondering when the Roman Empire fell, just wait. Because like we still carry this ridiculous ideology as a nation. That it's just about me. It's do what I want to do. It's do what feels good to me. Do what I happen to think right. Do what someone has suggested is correct in our current culture, and let the current culture decide how we move forward in things. And that is not how Jesus has called his church to be. The only time, and I do think it's important to be able to engage people within the culture. I don't necessarily think it's important that we need to be able to engage the culture, but we need to be able to engage the people within a culture, right? Paul said, I become all things to all people so that some might be saved. That's really the only place we see that. And then we see an illustration of where Paul is ministering, Paul is preaching, and Paul looks at their statue to an unknown God, and he takes that unknown God, and he's not saying that that statue is God, but he's letting them know the God whom you do not know who he is the God who I serve, is the God who sent me on mission, is the God who has just absolutely changed my life, right? And so that's the only place we really see that. Beyond that, it is God saying, this is how Jesus lives. This is the way, walk ye in it. This is how Jesus lives. And Jesus says, how about you deny yourself, you take up your cross, and you follow me. Right? When you deny yourself, you say, it's not about this culture. It's not about this world. It's not about what everybody else says and everybody else thinks and how everybody else thinks I should live. But I'm going to deny myself. I'm going to take up my cross. When I take up my cross, I'll take up the teaching of Jesus Christ. I'll take up the sacrificial life of Jesus Christ. I'll take up the decision to serve those in need just like Jesus did. I'm making the decision to become a foot washer. That is countercultural. Right? This culture is figure out how high you can get so you can pay somebody else to wash your feet and pay somebody to wash other people's feet. Right? But in the Bible, Jesus says, well, I'll do it. Let me do it. No, you guys aren't even allowed to wash my feet right now. I so need to make this point. I'm going to be the one washing your feet. John the Baptist? I doubt he was called John the Baptist back then. Probably just called John. I know you're wanting to baptize me, but I so need to let people see the standard that I'm setting. You're going to have to be the one who baptizes me. Like, everything is backwards. The Pharisees, what was their anthem? Their anthem was, anything you can do, I can do better. I can do anything better than you. Right? That was basically their anthem. But you've got to give, I mean, some of them have to have had their heart in the right place, you would think. Like all the Pharisees, they're just all horrible and bad. No, like, that's not the point of us seeing what the Pharisees did and how they believed. They were keepers of the law. There were some of them that just wanted to keep the law, wanted to please God. And so their anthem maybe wasn't that, but it was just that we have to work our way and sacrifice our way back to God. That there's got to be something I can do to gain my standing back. There's got to be enough animals I can sacrifice. There has to be a way that I can get enough incense that I can burn at the right times and follow enough of the right customs that I can fix this thing with God, this problem that exists. And I wonder what our anthem, and I'm separating us out into individual, like, what's your anthem? You know, well, I'm not sure. Like, I'd really have to think about it. You don't really have to think about it. There's not a moment in your life where you aren't singing your anthem. I mean, I was just super duper deep in sin yesterday. You're singing your anthem. Oh, Pastor Joy, my anthem is the one we sang a million times 20 minutes ago. It was 20 minutes ago. But it's inconsistent that we can have a different anthem on Saturday than we have on Sunday morning. And that's hard, and it sounds legalistic. We're like, well, it's not about me following the law. Jesus made it really clear. I can't work my way back to God. And you're right. I'm with you on that. But I was overwhelmed on Wednesday night. Prayer went long on Wednesday night because Ray asked me to close. And I'll let you know, honestly, usually if I'm asked to close, we close at about 6:45. I keep us pretty buttoned up, close at 6:45. We start at 6, end at 6:45. And so Ray's like, hey, whenever you feel like we're done, you know, would you close this tonight? And so I was like, all right. And so about 6:35, 6:40, I went and I grabbed the microphone. I just sat down. I think I was right here. And there was a song playing. It was, they were singing, "To Worship You, I Live, To Worship You, I Live, To Worship You, I Live, I Live to Worship You." And just the reality that every moment, every decision I make, whether I intend for it to be or not, is an act of worship. That does not mean it's an act of worship to God. It's an act of worship to something. That if we're slipping and we're falling into sin and we're continually falling into sin and we fall into sin and fall into sin and fall into sin, and I'm not saying that you're worshiping that specific sin, because usually whenever there's sinfulness in our life, it exists because we're trying to meet a need that we feel like isn't currently being met. And so we're worshiping something deeper. We're worshiping the need for affection. We're worshiping the need for acceptance. We're worshiping the need to feel normal again. We're worshiping the need to be better or to do better or to be more. Right? Those are the things that we're worshiping. It doesn't mean that you're like, well, I don't really talk about it, and it seems like in the Bible there's room for drinking alcohol, so like I don't really need to tell people that I drink alcohol and that, because like it's not really a sinful thing for me. But then as we begin to struggle with it more and more, and it, we go deeper into that pattern and overuse, and then all of a sudden we're slipping into where Jesus is very clear that, that drunkenness is not acceptable, that the Apostle Paul is very clear that drunkenness is literally listed as one of those things that are the works of the flesh, and if you do those things then you have no inheritance in the kingdom of heaven. Then that's the place where we have to figure out, what is it that I'm worshiping that is driving me deeper down into this realm? Not even necessarily of addiction, but beyond the place that God has clearly said, this is not okay. And there's a million things that we could discuss about, maybe we're using this to fulfill this. But you know what it is. And God's so good that he can let you know what those things are. That God can reveal to you even now as your heart is open to him and to say, God, what are the areas of my life, God, where I'm worshiping something that's not you? Because there should never be a time where we worship something that's not God, ever, right? There could be a time as a basketball coach during basketball season where I could begin to worship my job as a basketball coach more than I am worshiping God. When my position as a basketball coach, regardless of who hired me or why they hired me, the reason that I'm a basketball coach is because I believe there's a way for me to use the God-given gifts and abilities and even just my interest that God has placed in my life, and I can do good for the kingdom of God. But if I step outside of that, if I step outside of saying, how is it that I can build the kingdom of God? How is it that I can use basketball insight or basketball knowledge or the ability to have relationships and to help students know that there is such a thing as somebody who lives morally and upright and acceptable and pleasing before the Lord God Almighty, right? Like, whenever I let those things cloud my judgment, right? Then all of a sudden I've drifted from I'm doing what I can for the kingdom, and so therefore I do these other things in my life, to I do these things in my life and they distract me from the kingdom of God. If you have those things in your life that you were doing for the kingdom, but now you're doing for yourself, or you're doing for a standard of success, or you're doing so that somebody will finally think that you've made it, and you'll get the approval of that person who just never would approve of you, or those people who pushed you down, you're going to show them that you are enough, and so you are finally reaching above, and you are doing more, and it's no longer about, God, how can you use me for your kingdom? Then our anthem has become something that it should. Right? And so, as a husband, as a man of God in this place, the way you treat your spouse should be, by his stripes we are healed. What does that have to do with marriage? Well, it's got a lot to do with marriage, right? A lot of marriage needs healing in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. You been there? Say amen. Amen. By his nail-pierced hands we are free. Free from what? Free from the need to control. Free from needing somebody else's approval beyond what is rational. Right? Free from the need to meet somebody else's expectations that are unrealistic. Free from holding somebody to unrealistic expectations because that's what were placed on you and that's what you saw. And there was no, Jesus breaks generational curses. You don't have to do what your parents taught you anymore. Now, God will set you free from those things. And some of it, hopefully, your parents taught you right. And you say, this is pleasing to God. But God will set you free from having to do things the way that you've always seen them done. You are not your mom. You are not your dad. You are somebody new who Jesus has placed the mind of Christ within. By his blood, we're washed clean. Now we have the victory. The power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all. He's won our freedom. Jesus has won it all. Hallelujah, you've won the victory. Hallelujah, you've won it all for me. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King. God can resurrect anything in your life that is within the will of God. God can resurrect your broken relationships. God can resurrect your broken relationships. God can resurrect those broken dreams that you know were from God, but that you put to the side because you were fulfilling other things at some certain time. But you're like, I know God put that in my heart. I don't know why I ever got off of what God put in my heart. And so God's like, I want to restore that. I want to bring resurrection life to those things. God is risen. He is alive. He won the victory. He reigns on high. So as a man of God, as a husband, you live your whole life with that as the lens. You go to work as a carpenter with that as the lens. You go to work as a grocery store bagger because that is the lens. We do everything as unto Christ because my lens is everything I do it for God. How can God help me in any of it? God help me in all of it. That's the lens. And so we live out that anthem. But back to being over here. And I'm closing up here. So Jonas, if you go ahead and come, any of the worship team that wants to come play, you can too. You're all invited. But I was just wrecked with the reality that every moment is worship. And as we sang this anthem and we sang it over and over and over again, there's got to be something in our lives of Christ that we decide to get on repeat every single day. He said, "Well, I don't want to get a person of habit. I don't want to make it just where I'm just doing it because it's a habit." And you've got to start somewhere. And if you do not train yourself to do daily activities that help your relationship with God, then you will end up being trained to do anything else. You'll give your time to everything else. And when God is saying, "I want you to come back to me. I want you to give every moment to me. Every moment at work belongs to me. Every dollar you make belongs to the Lord God Almighty. Every thought that you think belongs to the Lord God Almighty. Every time you go and you make purchases, those moments belong to the Lord God Almighty. Every time you decide what you're going to watch on that television screen belongs to the Lord God Almighty." That every moment of our day can be worship. And I'm so moved by that because I so love when we're all in here and we're worshiping Jesus together. I mean, I'm just blown away. I'm up there playing the keyboard. I don't know if this is the largest group of people we've ever had together in this room to worship Jesus or not, but it's sure close. And I'm just like, God, this is just such a small piece of what heaven will be like. God, this is going to be so great. And we get to just do this forever. And we get to worship you. And we get to sing these songs. And we get all these anthems. And so it's just this special holy time. But the reality is that all time is holy. All time belongs to the Lord. Every moment belongs to the Lord. And just as excited as I am to see all of us in here and say, we're going to worship Jesus. Let's lift up a shout of praise. Let's say hallelujah. Let's lift up a hand clap of praise. As excited as I get about that, we've got to figure out a way to be excited about the mundane little things that we think don't matter. Because those are the moments when God says, do you even see that I'm here? Do you not recognize that I'm with you always? That you're just washing the dishes and you think you're just having to fulfill another task and you just don't even know how you're going to make it another day. And God's saying, I'm right here with you. Would you just do this for me? Would you just do the laundry for me? Forget everything else. You take care of them because you love me. Because you know what? I've called you into. You go to work and you make that money. Not so you can be, oh, so successful and you're just some kind of, you're just a figure in the, who cares about what kind of figure you are before men? And let's make it about who we are before God. God, have you called me to be successful in this way? God, have you called me to do the things that I'm doing right now? Because that is where I want to succeed. If I succeed in my time in worship from 10 o'clock to 10:40 or so, but then I fail the rest of the week in my anthem before God, then I fail and I miss the mark. And that's called sin. Missing the mark is called sin. You could be in here every single week and say, I'm pleasing to God. I show up, I mark the book, I mark the calendar. I'm here every single week, week in and week out. I go to prayer on Wednesday nights. But if that's the only time and you don't give all of the time equally to God, then that's called sin. Anytime we miss time, it's not just, well, he mentioned that one sin there, but how deep you might go into that. How about every moment of every day? That's what our God calls us into. When we sing those songs, and we sing about how holy God is, we sing how holy God is, that cannot just be God's holy from 10 o'clock to 10:40. No, it's got to be, God, I give you, the old song, God, I give you my life, I give you my soul, I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every step that, or something I take, now I'm not turning into police and staying, I'll be watching you. That's not it. It's the wrong song. But God is watching you. I'll literally never remember the song now, not today. But God wants your everything. What we do is we pray for Easter Sunday. And we say Easter Sunday is important, Easter Sunday is significant, because there's somebody who's going to come who doesn't normally come, and they need to accept Jesus Christ. And if that's you, those people with that thought are right. But Easter Sunday to me is more significant, because I might get 160 of you the week before Easter, but I'm going to get 200 of you on Easter. And we all need to hear that God wants every week, every moment, in every TV show, in every song, in every thought, in every click, in every tap on that tiny little phone screen that we think is somehow different because it's on a phone. No. He wants it all. And God wants the anthem of your life on repeat. God wants you day and night, night and day. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. God wants you day and night, night and day. Hallelujah, you've won the victory. You've won it all for me. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King. My King is alive. God wants that going through your mind all day long. Because when that's going through your mind all day long, you are closer with Him than you've ever been. Your relationship with Him begins to change. You begin to walk in greater authority than you used to walk in. You begin to understand that even though my prayers feel insignificant and they feel small, I know that God has done something in me. And if God has done that in me, then what will He do for somebody else? So I want us to bow our heads and close our eyes. This is going to sound like a cheap altar call where I'm going to get a bunch of hands to go up. And if we're honest, there will be a bunch of hands that go up. But the point isn't for me to say, okay, well, I got a bunch of people who raise their hands on Easter Sunday. The point is that we have to acknowledge where we're at. And once we acknowledge where we're at, we can ask God for the grace to not be there any longer. If you're in here and you say, I know good and well that I don't give God my every moment. I don't let an anthem arise in my heart as I'm doing the mundane things. I don't let God have the moments whenever I decide that I have a need for something greater than Him. And I need God's grace because I want that to be my life. So this isn't just the acknowledgement of where I'm at. This is saying, I know this is where I'm at, but I want my life to be that every moment is He's won the victory. He's won it all for me. Death couldn't hold Him down. I want my every moment to be that He is alive. I want my every moment to be by His stripes we are healed. by his nail-pierced hands were free. I want my every moment to be that, and it's not. And I want his grace because I want him to do that in my life. I want him to empower me so that that's who I am, that that's my life. That when people see me, that they finally say that there's something different about that person, about that man, about that woman. I don't know what it is, but there's something different about them. And inside, you'll know it's because my anthem changed, because my anthem shifted, because there was an Easter Sunday morning when I thought people needed salvation, but I really just needed God to draw me nearer to himself. If you're here and that's you, you say, that's my place. And I need God to give me the grace that I can live that 24-hour day, 7-day week anthem, and I believe he'll do it. Would you put your hand up across this room? Keep that hand up. That's me. I need that grace. I want it to be real. I want it to be true. Heavenly Father, I pray for every person with their hand up, God. Father, if they're not a follower of Jesus Christ, then right now, they'll understand that all they have to do is place their faith in Jesus and who you are and what you've done. That you are the perfect, sinless, spotless Lamb of God who died before, who was always God's plan, God, and that you died, you lived the life we couldn't live and died the death we deserved, that the resurrection power can be in us. And Jesus, we receive your grace in Jesus' name and receive your salvation. And Father, I pray, God, for every person with their hand lifted up right now who's saying that that is me. My life is not one where every single moment of every single day that my anthem is about God. My anthem is how can I live for Christ? How can I follow Jesus? How can God be at work in and through me for the sake of his kingdom and for the sake of others and for the sake of my family? That God, you give us a great portion of your grace in Jesus' name. That Father, that we would embed ourselves, that we would dig in and we would say, that is my position as a follower of Jesus Christ. That my anthem is every moment of every day. That I don't hold back. That I don't just give and pick and choose where God gets to have part of my life and where he doesn't. But God, that we would give our entire lives to you in Jesus' name. That every moment would be consumed with how God is at work in us and how God wants to work through us. That God, we would live every moment to glorify you. That God, even our sleep schedules would be saying, God, this is going to glorify you best. That our work schedules would be, how can we most glorify you with the situations and circumstances that you put us in? God, that your will would be done in us and through us. God, that we are broken. That we would never have another song to sing. And God, our worship is every moment of every day. God, help us to be as passionate about worshiping you with our living as we are about worshiping you with our singing. God, that these moments are great for the edification of the body. But God, you desire to send us out. God, that you broke your bread, you blessed it, you multiplied it. God, let that be us. Just take a moment right where you're at and just let faith rise. Let yourself believe God's doing it. Let yourself believe that God is at work inside of you. Let yourself believe that Jesus is restoring you. Let yourself believe that the work that Jesus did isn't just words on a book, but it's real life. Holy Spirit moving in this room right now in Jesus' name. Come on. Let yourself believe it, that God can do something that you've never experienced him do before. God, this is a miraculous work we're asking for. God, a miraculous grace we're asking for. God, a miraculous portion of your Spirit at work in our lives that we are asking for. God, we would fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith, believing you for greater and greater things. That we'd be a friend like Jesus has called us to be a friend. We'd be a spouse like God has called us to be. That we'd be a parent that you have called us to be. That we give the same forgiveness to others that we ask you to give of us. Let's all stand up.
Hallelujah, you have won the victory. Hallelujah, you have won it all for me. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King, seated in majesty. You are the risen
Father, we pray that there would be a perseverance, God, about us this week. That there just be an extra level of saying, not this time. There would be an extra level of saying, God, you can have my all. You can have every moment, God, this week. And God, we begin in that work, God. We see you faithful, God, to continue that in us, to deepen that in our relationship with you. God, we trust you. God, we believe as we follow your word, God, that you are faithful to complete the work that you started. We love you. We thank you for everybody that's here. Let your hand be over us, God. Bring as many of us as are willing back next week, God, to celebrate you once again. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Happy Easter. You are dismissed in Jesus' name.